Welcome to All Nations International Fellowship. We invite you to worship with us and receive the bread of life in today's message.
Maintenant, aujourd'hui, ne craignez point, car je vous annonce une bonne nouvelle qui sera pour tout le peuple un sujet d'une grande joie.
Parce que aujourd'hui, nous sommes dans la ville de David. 救主出生了, 祂就是主耶稣。
디질린 түшин байх даун дэлгэцэн 닐хүүхтэг таныр ол чарин. 이는 таныарт тэндэг байх олын.
Гапчаги 그 천사와 더불어 많은 하늘 군대가 나타나서 하나님을 찬양하여 말하였다.
엔무냠카 어스스 냥쿠폰 나 아스겐카이 나이 와사 시소 아멘
All right, here we go. Well, praise God. Hallelujah. Today is the day the Lord has made. I love that scripture. I say it all the time, and I'm going to continue to say it because we need to have an attitude of praise and of worship and keep our minds on those things that are pure and lovely and holy and of excellent, of worthy of praise, of good report. Amen. We don't want to keep our minds focused on the world's problems, the world's attitudes, though, because we need to be the people that are solving those issues, and we need to be the people that are a light in the midst of those issues. That's why it's important that we keep our minds focused on the Word of God, that we keep our minds focused on Jesus, because without that, then we become part of the problem instead of the solution to the problem. And that's part of my message today. I'm going to talk to us about the Lamb of God. This seems rather understood for this kind of crowd that's with us today, but I hope that we can receive a little bit of deeper revelation. Today we have a little bit of a Christmas message talking about the Lamb of God, but I hope that we can see a deeper message, the deeper root of the message as we go through these scriptures today. And so I'd like to encourage us, if you will, to go ahead and open your Bibles to Exodus 12:3-5-8 and 12 through 13. I'm combining together here several verses going to the key parts of this message. Exodus 12:3-5-8 and 12 through 13. And I will go ahead and read that for us. I'm reading the New Living Translation. And this is, of course, talking about Moses and the sacrificial lamb that was to protect them from the 10th plague, which was the angel of death, the plague of death. Amen. We're all familiar with the plague of death in these modern times. But let us read this account here from Scripture as we talk about the Lamb of God. It says, "Announce to the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each family must choose a lamb or a young goat for a sacrifice, one animal for each household. The animal you select must be a one-year-old male, either a sheep or a goat with no defects." There's a key, with no defects. "Take special care of this chosen animal until the evening of the 14th day of this first month. Then the whole assembly of the community of Israel must slaughter their lamb or young goat at twilight. they are to take some of the blood and smear it across the sides and top of the door frames of the houses where they eat the animal. The same night, they must roast the meat over a fire and eat it along with bitter salad greens and bread made without yeast. On that night, I will pass through the land of Egypt and strike down every firstborn son and firstborn male animal in the land of Egypt. I will execute judgment against all the gods of Egypt, for I am the Lord. But the blood on your doorpost will serve as a sign, marking the houses where you are staying. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. This plague of death will not touch you when I strike the land of Egypt. Amen. There is a lot of meat in that few verses right there. And we're going to see some parallels between this story and the Christmas story. And so I'd like to just keep in mind some thoughts here about the lamb that they were to choose must have no defects. There should be no blemishes, no spots, no disease, no broken bones, no problems with this lamb, a perfect specimen of a lamb that they were supposed to choose. And then that they were supposed to do two things with it. They were supposed to, after slaughtering it, they were supposed to post blood from the lamb over their doorpost so that that would be a sign for the death angel not to enter, not for the plague not to enter, and to for the basically the judgment of God upon sin was not to enter because of the blood of the lamb. And we're also going to see that the people here were supposed to eat. They were supposed to partake of the lamb and eat the meat, the flesh of the lamb after it was roasted. So we're going to see some parallels here that I hope to point out for us. You know, most, at least in the West, in America, where I'm from, we have a little nativity scene that we like to put out at Christmas time to remind us of the real meaning of Christmas. And I don't have anything against that. My dad makes little barns and sells them, and people can put the nativity scene in there. And I don't have any problem with that. But mostly it is rather unrealistic of what the real scene might have looked like. We can see some wise men and shepherds and Mary and Joseph and the little baby Jesus there in a comfy bed of hay. And that's kind of the Americanized scene, nativity scene of Christmas. But I'm going to take us through the story a little bit more closely today, and we're going to see the reality. We had the movie Dinner Party talking about fake faith and real faith. Well, we're going to take a look at the real faith today. Amen. So let's take a look at the traditional Christmas account today, Luke 2, 4 through 7. Luke 2, 4 through 7. And then we're going to read a little bit further. And it says, because Joseph was of a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, to whom he was engaged, who was now expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them. Continuing on, we're going to read Luke 2, 8 through 10, and then 12 through 14. Luke 2, 8 through 10, and 12 through 14. New Living Translation I'm reading. It says, That night there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel reassured them, "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people, and you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger." Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth with whom God is pleased. Amen. That is our text for today. And hopefully we can start to see some parallels here in this story. So the first thing I'd like to bring up here is we can see this picture that I got, and this tower here is the Tower of Eder, or maybe it's Eder, I'm not certain, but it's Tower of, we'll say Eder. And this is where the newborn lambs were born at. They were born for a specific purpose, which was sacrificial lambs, and they would be born there. They'd have some troughs, some mangers there, and these mangers were not what we look at today, like in the picture that I showed you of wood with hay. They would have been made of stone, probably carved out of a big piece of stone with a kind of a sunken place in the middle where the animals would come and eat their grain, come and eat their hay. And so the animals would lay in there. And the shepherds, for the weaker ones, would take the weaker ones in order to keep them safe and warm, would wrap them in cloth. And so they would keep them in this manger and keep them there so that their bones wouldn't get broken, so that they'd be warm from the cold, you know, because it's cold in the nights in the desert. And this is out in the desert in the north part of Bethlehem. And so they would wrap these little lambs there to keep them safe and warm inside this tower. Now, this is interesting that this tower that is there, used to be a watchtower, built to be a tower for war, to watch for enemies. And now this tower of war has been converted into a housing area for these lambs. A lot of significance there, that something that was meant for war now is turned into a place for a life of hope, of peace, that these lambs also were going to be sacrificial lambs, that they would be used to cover the sins of the people of Israel. They would be used as offerings for sin. And so something that was meant for war turning into a blessing for people, and something that would be there for to free them of their sins. Amen. So a lot of illustration here. So we can see that God has really set this scene up so that nobody can misunderstand what is happening here. God is the master of illustrations, and his master illustration was not lost on these shepherds. They understood completely the importance of what they were seeing. Here is, they're going down, they receive the message from the angels, they go to this place. It may have been in this very place that Mary and Joseph were. I don't know. We don't know for certain, but at least in the same vicinity, the same area that these lambs, these sacrificial lambs, were born, were raised. The fields surrounding them were places that were where the lambs would eat and grow into adult sheep, and they would be used for sacrifices. So the illustration here, when they go and they find this baby wrapped in snuggling cloth, lying in a stone manger, like one of these lambs, this was something they would have instantly been familiar and connected with, and they would have been saying, wow, look what God has done. They could see. They didn't just have to have the explanation from the angel. They could see for themselves this illustration, this connected visual illustration that God had painted for them, to understand that this was the sacrificial Lamb of God who had come to take away the sins of the world. This tower here was a monument, was a beacon that all of them could see, that everyone that was in the city, that was in the town, could look to the north and see this big tower of stone that was built there. And they can clearly see that this is a representation, this is an example, this is an illustration of what God wants to do in us and for us through the hope made into flesh, Jesus Christ. Amen. And that is still what he wants to do for us today, that he's got a sacrificial lamb for you and for I, that not just that doesn't just cover sin, but takes sin away. We're going to continue on with my next thoughts here. So in the shadow of this repurposed tower, amen, how many praise God that he is a God that repurposes you? When you were going on the wrong path, when you were didn't know where to turn next, when you didn't know where to go, when you were feeling like your purpose was God, come on, the Lamb of God comes along and he repurposes you for his glory. Amen. So in the shadow of this repurposed tower of war, God offers man under the banner of grace a peace offering. And whereas in the reverse, under the law of Moses, we had to offer God a peace offering. You see, mankind, these physical lambs, these animal lambs, were born to be a peace offering between man and God, something that man had to do in order to connect with God. Well, God is saying, well, here is my lamb that I am offering to you in the same tower or in the same vicinity as this repurposed tower, to say, I want to come and to offer you a peace offering. This isn't you trying to get to God. This is God giving you his Lamb of God, his peace offering to reconnect with a lost and broken down world. Come on, that's exciting. That's powerful. When you start to get the visual illustration of what God is doing here in this tower of war, in this city, that they can see this old repurposed tower of war, God is saying, here is my offering of peace, not for you to come to me, but for me to come down and reach out to you. Amen. That will make your day right there. So the lambs surrounding Jesus were for man to offer to God for the forgiveness of sin. But Jesus, the Lamb of God, was offered to man for the forgiveness of sin. That is a powerful understanding. When you start to see the great exchange happening in the Christmas story, it suddenly you see the plastic Mary and Joseph here and the plastic lamb and the plastic Jesus. Well, suddenly you get this traditional message and it comes to life again for you. You add a little seasoning, a little spice, a little salt to the message, and it just reinvigorates that message that we hear every year, but we're hearing again, I hope today, for a fresh time in a fresh way and a new way. Amen. The Lamb of God come down from heaven to offer us forgiveness of sins. Whereas under the law, it is us offering a lamb for sacrifice in order to get to God. Amen. That is the great exchange today in this Christmas season, but we're not done. Let's continue on. So we're talking about the Tower of Eder here. He was laid in a manger, a place where animals came to eat. We all know in the story that Mary wrapped him in snuggling cloths, just like the lambs were wrapped in snuggling cloths, laid in a manger, just like those lambs were laid in the manger to keep them safe, confined there so that they wouldn't break any bones and warm from the cold desert nights. Well, he was laid in a manger, in a place where animals came to eat, which is very much like what the Hebrew people did, that Moses told them they should kill and eat the roasted lamb, the sacrificial lamb, that the plague would not come into their house. And as the people ate the lamb and put the blood over the doorpost, they were protected from the judgment of God on the Egyptian people and on the Egyptian gods. Amen. So today, as we're getting ready for communion, Jesus offers his flesh, his blood to us to consume for the forgiveness of sins and for healing. So today, if you are sick, If you've got a fever, if you've got a sore throat, any aches and pains, or even if you want to have protection, of course, those of us that haven't been sick, we need protection. So I hope that today, as we get ready to start our communion in just a few minutes, that you can remember these two stories, that we look back in Exodus and we see the sacrificial lamb prepared, that the Hebrew people prepared. They ate the lamb, they put the blood over the doorpost, and they were protected against the judgment of God, against sin. And today we see the Christmas story, Jesus, the sacrificial lamb of God, wrapped in snuggling cloth, laid in a manger, where we can come and eat, where we can come and partake of the word of God. He said he was the bread of life, just like we had in the movie a few weeks ago, the bread of life given to us for our consumption, for our nourishment, for our strength, for our health, for our deliverance. Amen. We need to partake of the word of God, the bread of life. Amen. And we'll have one more slide here. You know, the story of Moses, and under the law, we have the covering from the curse. You know, the curse would not come in, but it would pass over them. So their sins were just covered during that time. Moses' lamb was a covering from the curse. But we know that Jesus, the Lamb of God, came to remove the curse from us. The Bible tells us that we are no longer under the curse of the law. We are no longer under sin. Romans 6 tells us that we are united with him in death, and we are united with him in new life. Romans 6 goes on to tell us that we are not obligated to do any of the things that our sin nature wants to do, that we are free from the slavery of sin and free from the effects of sin, which is sickness and disease. Sickness and disease are results of sin, of the curse of sin. So today, as we eat our communion, we know the curse placed on the world from the acts of sin, the disobedience against God, no longer applies to you and to I. And I'm going to finish. We had Exodus at the beginning of the Bible. We had the Christmas story in the middle. Now I'm going to take us to Revelation 22, verse 3. Revelation 22, verse 3 from the New Living Translation. It says, no longer will there be a curse upon anything. Praise God. Come on now. No longer will there be a curse upon anything. For the throne of God and the Lamb will be there, and his servants will worship him. Come on, Jesus. There will be a day coming when he will eradicate every curse off of the earth. Right now, only those that receive him as Lord and Savior can be removed from the curse, and we can receive healing because of the curse. We can receive forgiveness because from the curse. The Bible tells us in Psalms 103, don't forget any of his benefits, for he forgives all of your sins and he heals all of your diseases. If David, under the old covenant, understood that, then how much more should we receive it today, as we have the covenant of Jesus, the Lamb of God, who was shed, his blood was shed for us. Amen. So that's my message for today. Very short, to the point, and then I'm going to go ahead and close this out here, and we're going to have our communion time. So let me give you just another minute or two to go get some juice or grab a cracker or grab some bread.
Thank you for watching. We hope your faith is strengthened by today's message.
To learn more about Head Pastor Sean and Kim Freeman, please check them out at imprintinternational.com. Visit us on social media at these options. Pastor Sean's book, Church Media from the Ground Up, is available on Amazon and Kindle app.
God bless you and keep you. 上帝保佑.